Okay. Okay, deontology, human rights. There are two ways of thinking about ethics, two fundamentally opposed ways, which have sort of dominated the tradition. One way is probably the simplest way to put it is it might be economic thinking. It's in terms of what's best, or in terms of costs and benefits. So you think, well, you're thinking about what to do, ethics is about what should we do, and you think, well, I've got to do what's best, I've got to look at the some of the costs, some of the benefits, calculate as best as I can, and come up with the best policy. That's called consequential thinking, sometimes called teleological thinking, but consequential is probably a better term. You're thinking in terms of the consequences. And you imagine you've got a scale of value, so you can value consequences. For example, in terms of the quantity of happiness that a policy would bring about, or in terms of the quantity of pain that it might impose on somebody. If you're reading the papers, God help you, before the last election, you'll have seen that nearly all political thinking, at least for that election, went on in terms of costs and benefits. In fact, take away the benefits, impose the costs on the poor, make sure the rich aren't taxed, and so on. Those are all consequential arguments. However, arguably, at the back of them, there exists another set of thoughts, another kind of thinking. And this is thinking which isn't forward-looking. It's not in terms of consequences. It's in terms of notions like rights, duties, preceding events in the light of which you have to do something or feel you ought to do it. So you're looking backwards rather than forwards. And that might sound strange, because after all, if you're thinking about what to do, you can only affect the future. Why bother about the past? But when you think about it, a lot of our decisions are determined by the past. Your parents look after you because your mother gave birth to you, or they've undertaken an obligation to do so. You might do better somewhere else, but nevertheless the system is such that because they're your parents, they feel an obligation to you. And maybe in later life, because they're your parents, you feel an obligation to them when they become my age and in their dotage and need your help. So that's backward looking, because it's what's happened in the past. Or again, you know, we better invite Fred to the party. Ooh, why, Fred's a terrible bore, consequential thinking. Yes, but he invited us to his party, backwards looking. And there's a sort of sense that if somebody invited you to his party, then other things being equal, you ought to invite them back. And that way of thinking typically gives rise not to notions of what's a cost or what's a benefit, what it's best to do, what is not the best to do, but in terms of duties, obligations, rights. And that cast of thought is what we call deontological. It's from the Greek for duty. So deontological thinking gives you your, as it were, structure of obligations or duties or rights. Consequential thinking gives you consequences. And the question, a big question that's sort of informed an awful lot of moral philosophy, is how we're to see these two different ways of thinking as related. Can we unify them under one set of principles or set of thoughts about human life? Or is it always just two different things which can, of course, clash? Because it may be that in terms of consequences you should do one thing, but the structure of rights and obligations and duties that you feel you lie under tells you to do something else. So rights can, rights especially, can conflict with consequences. Take a simple example. Well, here's an example from Hume. Hume talked of, David Hume, 18th century philosopher, you've probably mostly heard of him. You soon will if you come to the NCH. He gives the example of, I think it was Cyrus, I may be wrong about that, anyhow, an old king of Persia, who, when he was a young man, he saw or heard of a case in which one person in the city, let's say, was tall but had a short coat, and another person in the city was short and had a tall had a long coat, a coat too long for him. And Cyrus said, well, obviously they should swap, it'd be better if they swapped. So the tall person gets the long coat and the short person gets the short coat. and his tutor clipped him around the ear, or whatever they did in Persia to, by way of educational technology, and said no, because that infringes their property rights. You could ask them to agree to this swap, and if they agreed, well and good. But you can't just take somebody's coat from them and give it to somebody else, because the consequences would be better. You're infringing on their property right. And of course, property rights are one of the most important rights we think we have. You know, if your neighbor, as you sit here, suddenly reaches over and takes your pen, you'd be dumbfounded. I mean, it's just so much not the thing you do. And if they said, yes, but you see, I've got more need of it than you, I'd say, it doesn't matter, it's my pen, get your hands off it. So that's a question where we don't think consequentially, we think in terms of the structure that already exists. Okay, so how do these two ways of thinking relate to each other? Well, there are two proposals really have dominated the scene. One is that they can somehow be unified. And this gives rise to an ism. Philosophy is rather full of isms, and they can be treacherous. But the ism is called indirect utilitarianism, or indirect consequentialism. What does that mean? Well, the idea would be that if you want things to go well, people have to know how they stand with this relation to each other. So you're going to need policies and rules, conventions of how to behave. We couldn't even speak to each other unless there are conventions of language, for example, determining how to put a sentence together, what words mean, and so on. And we trust those conventions and abide by them without thinking about it. Similarly, you know, rules of the road, drive on the left. You need a convention. Doesn't matter which convention you have, over the channel they drive on the right. But you've got to have a convention, otherwise all hell breaks loose. So the indirect consequentialist says, look, let's split our problems in living together into two different areas. There's first, which conventions and rules have we to adopt? And that can be thought about consequentially. Adopt the ones that are best. If it comes to driving on the left, driving on the right, I don't think anybody's ever produced an argument for saying one of those conventions is better than the other. I believe that the convention of driving on the left sprung up historically because it enabled you to pass the other guy with your right hand towards him, and that meant you could run him through with your sword. But that's not any more a reason for driving on the M1 on the left. That apart, it really doesn't matter which convention you adopt. But for some things, it might. Suppose you imagine a world without property. So there's no convention or rule determining that you shouldn't just reach over and grab somebody's something or other. Then arguably, things would go much worse, because you wouldn't have any security. You wouldn't know when you went home whether your home was going to be occupied by somebody else. You wouldn't know when you got up in the morning, whether you could get into your car or not, because there'd be no such thing as your car. It would just be a car, which anybody might take. So without the security that's afforded by property conventions, things would presumably go much worse. So the indirect consequentialist, or indirect utilitarian, same thing for today, they say, okay, we split the problem into two. We choose the conventions and rules with an eye to utility, an eye to what makes things go best, least worst, but then we abide by the rules. So we've got sometimes called rule utilitarianism, but indirect utilitarianism is actually a slightly better name. It doesn't very much matter. And the utilitarian can go away sort of rather pleased with himself, the consequentialist, because consequences are still in the saddle. Consequences are still, as it were, what drives the whole show. It's making human life go best, and that's valued, that's estimated in terms of the consequences. On the other hand, you're giving a crumb, at least, to the deontologist, to the person who stresses the rights, duties, obligations side of things, Because they're saying, yes, 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 we're not against those. We just think they derive their utility, they derive their value from their utility. But once we've got them, yeah, we really like them. And we're going to abide by them. The indirect consequentialists in the tradition, I would argue it, they include Hume, although Hume is a little bit tricky to interpret. I would also argue that they include John Stuart Mill, who's the most famous utilitarian of the 19th century, although Mill is notoriously inconsistent and contradicts himself and is, doesn't say the same on page 2 as he said on page 1 and so on, which makes him an ideal subject for academic examinations. So you can say, is Mill best described as an indirect utilitarian? Oh my God, you have to write for 3 hours on that. So anyhow, I think that the best parts of Mill's thought show him to be an indirect utilitarian. Okay, do you all feel you've got the grip of that? That's okay. A different approach to the whole bit between rights, duties, obligations, that side of things, versus what's best, that side of things, but sees rights, duties, and obligations not as deriving from thoughts about what's best, but as actually having a different pedigree altogether, coming from some other, as it were, way of thinking. And the chief proponent of this split is the famous Immanuel Kant. You may have heard of him, great German philosopher, lived in Königsberg or Kaliningrad on the Baltic Sea, never traveled, never went outside northern Prussia, and yet wrote these fantastic books. And Kant's approach to ethics doesn't start off from what's best. It starts off from what he calls the maxim of an action, the intention of an action, or the principle which you're following as you act in some particular way, and you've got to ask a question of that principle. And the question is, could you will that it's maximized, that it's a principle which everybody follows? Could you will that it's a principle which everybody follows? And if it passes that test, fine, but if it doesn't pass that test, it's out. You must not do it. So it's a very much a theory that goes straight for obligations, and this is called the test of the categorical imperative. And Kant's thought here, again, is very difficult to interpret, but the best example he's got is something like this. That's the example of the lying promise. So you're in difficulties, perhaps financial difficulties, let's say. You think you'd love to borrow some money from somebody, but nobody will lend you any money unless you promise to pay it back. So you say, okay, well, I'm not going to be able to pay it back, still I'm going to promise to pay it back. That way I'll get the money. So your policy, as it were, your maxim of your action, your intention, is basically to cheat. It's to give the lying promise, to give the promise knowing that you've no intention or capacity to keep it. But still, that'll get you the money. So that's a pretty, I mean, you'd all think that's a bit iffy, at least. I take it you'd all think that's a bit iffy. Put your hands up if you think that's okay. No? Okay. So it's a bit iffy. And Kant wants to say, yes, why is it iffy? Utilitarian answer, because things go badly if you behave like that. Kantian answer, no. It's iffy because you couldn't consistently want everybody to behave like that. And the reason why not is quite interesting. There's a kind of contradiction in the offing. Because suppose it became so that everybody did behave like that, then paradoxically, fairly quickly, it might emerge that nobody could behave like that because the whole institution of promising would disappear. It would break down. The words, I promise to pay you back, would cease to have any meaning in a world in which it's known that nobody utters them sincerely, or that nobody can be relied upon to utter them sincerely. So the whole idea of giving a promise would just disappear. Be like the Greek government saying, "I promise to repay you." So Kant's idea was that if there's this contradiction in conception, that is, you're acting in such a way that if everybody acted like that, the institution or the conventions under which you're acting would collapse, they'd have no role, then that's a particularly self-undermining or kind of action. That's the test of the categorical imperative. And he tried to derive the idea of obligation, duty, and rights from that alone. And that gave them some kind of absolute force which he thought the utilitarian couldn't give them, or even the indirect utilitarian couldn't give them. And a lot of moral philosophy concerns whether Kant was right about that. There are Kantians in the contemporary academy. There are indirect utilitarians. I'm an indirect utilitarian, an indirect consequentialist. But there are Kantians knocking about. And in fact, in the United States especially, Kantianism is probably the dominant ism. The difficulty with Kant's test is it really is free from utilitarian or consequentialist basis, a utilitarian or consequentialist basis, as it seems to be. Kant obviously thought it was, but when you think about it, okay, suppose the convention governing the giving of promises does disappear. So what? Well, you could imagine somebody arguing that life would go better, or at least not go badly. I think it would go badly with no capacity to give each other promises and so on. But somebody might say, well, I don't mind acting in a way that undermines an institution if I actually think that life would go better if the institution withered away. So, or even if I don't care about it, either way. So take, say, the conventions governing credit cards. I'm not sure what age you're allowed to carry a credit card. You're all too young to carry credit cards. You know how they work. The parents pull out a piece of plastic and you get your nice new whatever. Well, some people can and afford to and do pay off their credit card every month, in which case there's no interest on the card. Other people, of course, either can't or don't want to, and they have to pay interest. The system works because enough people are in the second category. The banks only issue credit cards because they can rely on the interest coming in. So suppose everybody paid off their credit card every month. Well, arguably, the whole institution would collapse. There'd be no more credit cards because the issuing banks wouldn't make a profit, and then they wouldn't do it. So the whole idea is it depends on enough people staying in debt and having to service the interest of that debt. Does that afford an argument that it's wrong for me to pay off my credit card at the end of every month? I suppose I can afford to do so, and I'm prudent, I don't like paying interest, so I choose to do so. I'm acting in a way such that if everybody acted that way, the way of acting would collapse, it would disappear, because there'd be no credit cards left to pay off or not. So I'm doing something which sounds very like breaking the categorical imperative. I'm acting in such a way that if everybody acted that way, the thing would collapse. But that's fine. I say, yeah, sure. First of all, I'm pretty sure not everybody's going to act that way, because lots and lots of people can't afford to pay off their credit cards. And secondly, if it did happen, well, you know, one of those things. Maybe life would go better, maybe it would go worse, I don't know. A lot of people get into very serious credit card debt. A lot of people enjoy using credit cards, true, but how's the cost and the balance, how's the cost and the benefits going to, how are they going to be weighed? Maybe it'd be better for the world if we all went back. In fact, when I grew up, when I was your age pretty well, credit cards were more or less unheard of, and everything was done on what's called hire purchase. Or you saved and then you bought whatever you could. And some people think it would be better if we went back to that world. Well, I'm not an economist, so I don't tell you about that. I'm not too economist, so I don't tell you contradictory things about that. But in any case, I don't feel guilty about paying off my credit card every month, certainly when I can afford to do so. So there seems to be something missing in Kant's test. And this is where the indirect utilitarian is going to come back and say, what's missing is he has failed to think about the consequences of the institution under which you're acting, or the way you're acting, collapsing. If some ways of act collapse, it may be good for us. If some other ways of act collapse, may be bad for us. So he's got to bring back consequences. This is what the indirect utilitarians say. This is what John Stuart Mill said. And as I say, it's a major issue in the contemporary academy whether John Stuart Mill and the indirect utilitarians are right about this, or whether Kant's right about it. Have I got five more minutes? Am I okay for five? Okay. I'll just finish up by saying something else about rights and costs and benefits. A way of thinking about rights, duties, obligations, which has been quite popular, is that they trump cost benefits. Let's go back to Cyrus and the coat. Tutor who clipped Cyrus around the ear was trying to teach him that property rights trump. They overcome. They, as it were, beat out consequential reasoning. Admittedly, it would be better if the tall guy got the long coat and the short guy got the short coat, but it doesn't matter. That's his coat. If he doesn't want to give it up, he can keep it. The property right in this case, is trumping cost-benefit analyses. And this is how we often think. Suppose you own a house in Hay-on-Wye. You don't want people to park on your front lawn during the festival. You can put out a notice saying you're not to park on my front lawn, and the law will protect you. And if somebody does come and park on your front lawn, you can get them towed away or whatever. So you've got a property right, it trumps. Now, it might have been a good thing that they parked on your front lawn. They were important, distinguished visiting professors who had important talks to give, and you weren't particularly bothered about your front lawn anyhow. Doesn't matter. The property right trumps the consequences. That obviously grates on economists. Economists deal in costs and benefits. They don't like the idea that there are elements of decision-making in play which trump costs and benefits. Our rights trumps. And the problem is that they can't all be, because rights can clash. You can get cases where somebody's right in one thing comes in conflict with somebody's right to something else. And then there's a kind of standoff unless consequences come in to break the jam. A nice case of this kind is provided by the economist Amartya Sen, very distinguished economist, some of you may have heard of. He gave the example as follows. Suppose you live in a mixed race neighborhood and your friend runs the corner shop, you owe obligations of trust to him. He trusts you, you trust him, and he's a very nice guy and you're very fond of him. And you happen to overhear a gang of racist thugs plotting to attack him and his shop that evening. You happen to overhear that. And that's terrible, and you really want to warn him. And you feel he's got a right to be warned. Anybody's got a right to be warned that somebody's planning to attack them. Unfortunately, he's somewhere else. He's out of earshot. He's out of telephone range. The only way you can think of getting a warning to him is to use, your friend's bicycle and cycle off to where he is. But your friend's not around either. So it means taking his bicycle without his permission. Now, normally taking, I've got a ride, I've got a bicycle, and I've got a right that nobody takes it and uses it without my permission. So it would be infringing a right, a person's right to, as it were, be able to dictate who uses his bicycle and when, if I just take it and go. On the other hand, I'm ignoring the shopkeeper's right if I don't get a warning to him. So here we have a conflict of two rights. The only way I can, as it were, act in accordance with one person's right is by doing something which infringes somebody else's rights. And Sen said that's the problem with absolutist thoughts about rights. If you say rights close the conversation, they trump other considerations. You won't be able to think intelligently about these cases where rights conflict and where one right trumps another. And of course, although that's a very artificial case, you get cases in real politics. A lot of people would say that they have a right that governments and airlines should enable cheap and convenient travel. Heathrow's only got one runway. Maybe the only way anybody could act in accordance with that right is by allowing flights in during the night because the airport's so crowded. But that conflicts with the people in Hounslow's right to a good night's sleep because it would be very noisy for everybody in West London if you allow flights in overnight. So again, you can see things as a conflict of rights. The question is then which right you think triumphs. And Sen used that as an argument, saying you've got to get back to cost-benefit, utilitarian, consequentialist thinking. Okay, so those are some of the issues that surround how you think about rights, duties, obligations, deontological notions, as they're called, against how you think about consequences. And I've really just scratched the surface. It's a very interesting area. One thing I haven't talked about is the difficulty of measuring costs and benefits. The old utilitarians thought that would be easy. Nobody thinks that anymore. Okay, thanks very much.